God, man. Some of us probably think we're doing him a favor. He's doing us one. This is kind of unannounced, but I got a notebook for someone who loves to take notes. Does anyone love to take notes? I love note taking. Really? I've given you two, and you can't find them. You're punished. He's naughty, is what he is. You're not going to make fun of Hannah now, are you, Jerome, with her husband right there next to her? I remember last week. Y'all remember that last week, don't you? Uh-huh. He's making fun of your wife, just saying. Oh, yeah, oh, really? Mm-hmm. You better hide under that hood, boy. So Christmas is upon us, isn't it? Crazy times, man. Crazy time of year. Getting ready to celebrate Christmas holiday. Just keeps coming every year, right? Never stops, never stops. Well, I'm thankful to be able to celebrate it this year with my family here. Thankful for all of you being here. It's good. It's good. Who's that young guy right there? What's your name? What is it?
Gavin.
You know what I hated when I used to start going to church? When someone did this. It's almost as bad as the meet and greet. Everyone shake a hand, hug a neck. Don't touch me. Those were good times. Oh, man. Well, I want to take a few minutes and pray with you first. Get that connection going, you know? Who wants to hear from me tonight? That's right. That's good. That's good. I don't want to hear from me either. I don't want to hear from me either. So, you know what's good? You know what's neat is that God wrote a book. And I don't have to be creative. I don't have to make anything up. It's all in there. It's just like Prego. It's in there. That's what we're going to do tonight. So, like, if I see some faces out here I'm not really familiar with, if you are wondering, like, you've been prayed for, and we want you to be a Christian. That's it. Like, I'm not hiding it. Like, we're not going to sneak one in on you. We want you to be a Christian. We want you to know and love God through his son, Jesus. And that's the holiday that we're getting ready to celebrate. So we've been praying for you. And we would like nothing more than for you to just say, I'm totally in, Jesus. I've heard about you. But our prayer here tonight is that you would go from beyond hearing about him and experiencing him here. And so if you experience, I'll tell you something, if you've experienced Jesus, and I don't even know if I should say this, but I've never said anything right in this church. If you've ever been drunk, it's the best drunk you could be. Man, it's intoxicating. It's awesome. It's awesome. And you can't get enough. Can't get enough of them. So I want to pray with you, and then and let's just see if God will talk to us tonight, somehow, some way. Lord, I'm very much aware of my own weaknesses, and I certainly am sick and tired of hearing my own voice. I speak for my wife on that one, I'm sure. Lord, we desperately want to hear from you tonight. We've heard about you. We know you wrote a book. You've spoken to people over the years in a variety of different ways through different prophets and such, but here in these last days, you've spoken to us through your Son, is what your word says, and so we want to hear from the Son. We want to hear from you, Lord Jesus, tonight. I thank you for this church, Lord. I thank you for every person who's ever called this place their home. I thank you for their faithfulness in attendance, their faithfulness in serving. I thank you for the opportunity to come here tonight to share your word with people that they might know you and love you forever. It is your desire, Lord, as you've instructed us in your word, that every person would come to know Jesus, to be saved and come to the understanding of the truth. And that is what we're here to do tonight. We are here to hear from you, to learn the truth, and is because of the truth that sets us free. And so that's what we want tonight. We want to hear from you. We want to hear truth, and we want to be set free because of it. So we pray, Father, that you would send your Spirit to convict us of sin. We pray that you will lead us into all truth, and that it would be received. And we want you to impact everyone here tonight. We want to hear from you. We want to truly be changed because we met with the Creator. It's kind of crazy to say. We met with the Creator of the universe. That's what we want. And so, like Paul, Lord, use this foolish preaching to get your job done. We just welcome you to have your way in our life. True change tonight. Lord, that's what we desire. Help us to understand this Christmas holiday. Help us to understand what it's all about. Give us fresh perspective as we get ready to celebrate this joyous day with friends and family. Give us a new understanding and a new appreciation for this holiday, for who you are, what you came to do, what you're doing now, and what you want to do through us right here, your people. We thank you. And I also want to ask for your blessing on every pastor in this community that will present your word, your message to their congregation tomorrow morning. I pray, Lord, that your Spirit would be in their message and it would produce much fruit and advancement for your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. So we started this message series a couple weeks ago in anticipation of Christmas, and so we titled it. I don't title everything, but I this is the title I got. It's I Came To. The reason why we started it is because if you go up and down the aisles of any church and you ask, you know, why did Jesus come? Everyone will have a different opinion as to why Jesus came, and a lot of them are valid. Some are true, some are not. I don't know. But the beautiful thing is that, like I said before, God, can you turn me down just a hair, anyone? God wrote a book, and in his book, you'll see that Jesus actually tells us why he came. So isn't that good news that you don't have to guess? It's kind of cool. He is clear in his word why he came. And so we started a couple weeks ago to clearly identify the reason why Jesus came down from heaven to this earth. And it's not just, well, because he just died for sinners. I get that, but there's more to it than that. We started the first week, we grabbed something out of the Gospel of Luke where Jesus opens up the scroll of Isaiah and he reads this one spot that Jews have been reading and waiting for almost 800 years. They've been waiting for this Messiah to come, and he opens up the scroll, and he reads this part. He said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor," which was who? What? Yeah, everybody. To heal the brokenhearted, which was who? Everybody. So the blind would see. Everybody, and to set at liberty those who have been bruised, which is who? Everybody, okay? And he said, "I'm here to declare that the Lord's favor is here." And then he puts the scroll down and he goes, "Yeah, that's me. I'm right here in front of you." I mean, can you imagine that? If Jesus walked in here, you've been thinking about him all this time, and he walks in right in front of you, and he's like, "Yeah, it's me. Time to repent. Let's go. Let's get it done." And so we started there the first week, and then the next week we read this little story about Zacchaeus, and Mary knew that song, and like I said, if you don't know that song, Mimi still has her flannel board, and she will be happy to teach you the story of Zacchaeus, and so Jesus goes to this low life tax collector's house, and everyone gets saved, and Jesus says that I came, there it is again, I came to seek and save that which was lost, okay? That which was lost. So we saw that. Well, this week, we're going to look at another verse. But leading up to this week, we've talked about eternal life. He said he came to seek and save eternal life, forever, right? Forever. That's what we talked about. He came for everyone to save him forever. That's the first 2 weeks. But this week is a little bit different. This week, the verse is found in John. It's John 10:10. It used to be my favorite verse in the Bible until I read Colossians 1:16, which says that everything was created by him. And anyone know the rest of it? For him. Mary's heard me say that 400 times, right? Or more. And I'll never stop saying it, right? That's the fuel for Christian ministry, is that everything was created for him, right? And so you wake up in the morning, why? For him. You go to work, why? For him. You parent your kids, why? For him. You're a husband, for him. You're a wife, for him. Everything you do is what? For him, right? That's why we live. Okay, but this week is a little bit different. This week we're talking about the here and now. We're not talking about necessarily the eternal work of Christ, but he said in John 10:10 that I came that you might have life and have it abundantly. And that's what we're going to talk about tonight. We're going to talk about that verse right there. Okay, that's now. You know, some people think that you have to just live in hell for 70 or 80 years, and then finally someday you're going to go to the gates of heaven. They're going to let you in, and finally you can go, oh, finally, right? Okay, I get that. We probably will to a certain extent because it's going to be way better than, as good as it could get here, it's still going to be way better there. That was a good place for an amen. But he said that he came that you might have an abundant life. Like right now, it's not supposed to suck until you die. It's supposed to be good. Let me give you some synonyms for abundant. Plentiful. Rich, don't be deceived. That doesn't mean you're going to be loaded. Abounding, generous. So if you are rich, you know what you're supposed to do with it. Give it away, give it away, give it away now, right? Bountiful. Think of a fruit basket there. I don't know why. Large, or if you're from Boston, large. Huge, great. I didn't say wicked large, just large. Great and overflowing. I like that one. I like that word, overflowing, right? You got so much of it. Things are so good, you got to give it away, right? It's falling out of your pockets. I got so much good stuff that everybody can pick it up when I go buy them, right? It's so good. It's kind of like Joseph when he was in the house with Potiphar. He says that everything in Potiphar's house went well. Why? Joseph was there. Not because Potiphar believed in God or nothing like that. It's because of Joseph. Here's the definition of abundance. Existing or available in large quantities or plentiful. Use that word twice. Today's vernacular might say we're living large, right? We're living large. So let's do this. Let's figure out what in the world this abundant life looks like. I want to do this. I want to take you way, way back. We're going to talk about our life now, but I want to take you way, way back. Way back. Ask me how far back. Way back. I'll take you back to Genesis. This is what I'm talking about. When I'm talking about living large, I'm talking about an abundant life. Let's look at when God first created us, right? When he first created us, it says in Genesis 1:26, God says, let us make people in our image to be like us, right? That is what is called the Imago Dei, okay? Did you know that you're the only creation anywhere that's like God? Did you know that? Like if someone wants to see God, the best shot they got is looking at you. That's scary, right? But it's true, right? He made you in his image. What does that mean then? Just you have innate worth. Like like I heard another preacher saying this one time, and I just want to echo it. He said that if we were running out of money at my house, and I couldn't afford food, and I had a dog, and I had my wife, I wouldn't have to think about which one we're getting rid of. Do you understand? That there's just value in the fact that you are a human being. You have worth. You have value. That's the Imago Dei. Okay? Then we see in Genesis 1:28, just two verses later, God gives man purpose. It says that we should be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and govern the earth and reign over the earth and all of its inhabitants. So we have purpose. He also, in Genesis 1:29, the very next verse, he talks about this, all the great and plentiful food that he's given. Who likes to go out to dinner? Right? Everybody loves to go out to dinner. We love good food, right? And you read in the Genesis account that God gave
them plenty of wonderful food. In chapter 2, verse 18 and 19, you see that God gave Adam a woman to love. So vice versa, right? God gave Eve a man to love. So that we have value, we have purpose, we're provided for, we have someone to love. Then he gives them a great place to live. Genesis 2, 8 through 17, you're going to see that he describes Eden and he uses words like beautiful and aromatic and delicious. Those are good words, right? But, and I hate to use the word but, and a lot of times you say but, things are going to get better. But in this case, things get really, really bad. See, the serpent comes along and, you know, whammo, right? And it's not so much beautiful and aromatic and delicious anymore. We see things like this show up. They're naked. They're ashamed. They're blaming. Hey, it was that woman you gave me. It was the serpent. It wasn't me. So they're ashamed. They're blaming. There's fear. It says that there's enmity between man and all the other creatures. There's pain that's sharpened. Relational strife shows up in the home in Genesis 3:16, where it says that the woman will hit her desires to rule over her man. So you can see the fighting already starting, right? That's not a good time to elbow your spouse, okay? But so now instead, what we see is instead of purpose, we see toil and trouble and barely being able to scrape up a living on the Eden that he gave him. Okay, things got bad in a hurry. Now, listen, I'm not ripping, but just get married, have a few teenagers, and put on the 6 o'clock news, and you can see how this is continuing to flesh out right now. All right, it doesn't end. It's still going on right now, okay? In Romans chapter 1, I want to read you something. You can see that this problem that occurred starts to take on epic proportions, okay? Romans chapter 1. If you want to, you can read it along with me, but you don't have to. I'll read it for you. Romans chapter 1, because I'm going to skip around. Romans chapter 1, you can see it goes beyond Adam and Eve. It goes chapter 1, verse 21. It says that they begin to... They know God, but they don't worship him as God. They don't even give him thanks. They begin to think up foolish ideas of what God is like. Their minds became dark and confused. They became utter fools. They worshiped idols. They did vile and degrading things to each other's bodies. Traded the truth about God for a lie. Instead of having normal sexual relations, man, woman, they were burning for lust for the same sex, and then it gets worse from there. Listen, I'm giving you this. I'm painting a dark picture so you understand the blessing that you have if you're not immersed in this anymore. The darker the hole, the more appreciated the light, right? Okay, so that's what I'm doing. It goes on to say that their lives became full of every kind. Listen, watch the news, right? Watch the news. Wickedness, sin, greed, hate, envy, murder, quarreling, deception, malicious behavior, gossip. They're backstabbers, haters of God, insolent, proud, boastful. They invent new ways of sinning. You got buddies like that? They come up with new ways of sinning. It's not good enough to do it this way anymore. I need deeper and darker. I love this one. God groups this one in there. Disobeys their parents. Yeah, what are you turning around for? Huh? Huh? Oh, that's a bad one. He groups it in with haters of God. Listen, I'm joking, but it's not a joke. He goes on. They refuse to understand. They break their promises. Oh, I hate that one, for the record. Are heartless, have no mercy. They know God's justice requires that those who do these things deserve to die, yet they do them anyway. Worse yet, they encourage others to do them too. It got bad in a hurry. The lovely serpent, he bruises your heel, and as you malfunction, right, he bruises the heel, the snake, and you're malfunctioning. You're walking through life with a limp. You've been created to flourish, and to have this abundant life that you see in the garden, and then the serpent comes along and he bruises you, and now you're malfunctioning, and you're all doing that. Okay, you are. I am too. We're all malfunctioning. We're not operating as God has designed us to. And as we malfunction, Galatians 5:19 says that the results of this are very clear, and you can see it are all around you. Okay, all around you. Sexual immorality in its variety, in its various forms, impurity, lustful pleasures, idolatry, sorcery, hostility, quarreling, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambition, dissension, division, envy, drunkenness, wild parties, some translations say orgies, etc., and other sins such as these. Come on now, right? The lovely serpent. Listen, I'm not proud of this, but I have a microphone, so I have the opportunity to do it. I graduated with honors from Galatians 5:19. Okay, have you ever heard of egregio cum laude? Okay, that is that's the highest level of praise and success at the scholarly level. That you never hear of that one. It's very uncommon. That's for the person who gets perfect grades in honors classes. That was me. Okay? Am I alone? Anyone else? Yeah, I was there. Okay? I was there. And it was awful. It was awful. But here's the problem with that. Romans 1:27, very, very clear. And that's what we do around here. We just read the Bible. Amen? Romans 1:27 says that as a result of this sin, people suffer within themselves the penalty that they deserve. And I felt it. And you have too. And the question is how much more suffering are you willing to take? How much more battery acid will you drink down your throat before you're finally tired of it? I was tired of it, and I gave it up. And I hope you will hear tonight too. David felt it. In Psalm 32, it says that his sin made him feel like his body was wasting away. Anyone? Yeah. It goes on in that same psalm, it says that he groaned all day long. I've had the distinct pleasure at times, but sometimes it's difficult to sit next to the bed, you know, when people are dying. Okay, and if you ever go into a hospital or hospice or an old age home where they're close to the end of life, okay, walk through the lobby and you're going to hear it. Oh, it's nothing to laugh about either. It's awful. It's their pains. Their pain and their suffering, and they can't stop the groaning. Oh, you hear it like a choir going through the building. Anyone ever heard it? And that's what David felt like because of his sin. He was a young, energetic, powerful leader of this nation. He was rich. He had it all, but yet he was like a dead man groaning in pain because of his sin. And we've felt it. It goes on to say, as God's heavy hand of discipline was on him, his strength evaporated. It evaporated. Listen, when you just got to know this. Okay, the Bible says it, and I agree. Certainly your sin will find you out. It will. There's result for your sin. There's always results for your sin. I have my own list. I graduated from Galatians 5, but I got my own list. Anyone have their own list? I got my own list. You want to hear my list? Yeah, my list is this. Broke, tired, fired, divorced, sick, often ashamed of what I've done. Do you know I can remember back, and this is not to, don't laugh. I was so drunk one time in South Carolina, I was on the golf tour, that I was so wasted out of my mind, I woke up the next morning in the bushes in front of a hotel. I didn't even know how I got there. I could have been dead. And that's the result of your choice to sin. This is what the serpent has done to us. I'm left afraid. I'm left embarrassed, of course. You know, there's some young people in the room, so I'm, you know.
you know, but when you pee all over yourself and you're falling on your face, and like, that's not good. And that's the result of the sinful choices of our life. This is what David refers to in Psalm 51 as the stain of my sin. It's what's left in the wake of my sins behind me. That's what is left behind, the stain of my sin. It's what clings to me long after the fun of the sin is over. It's the stain that's left there. And we all have to deal with that. It looks to some as regret. Anyone? It's a good, listen, seriously, raise your hand. Regret. Because there's people in the room that maybe not, they don't understand, that like they might feel alone or so shameful because they're feeling it, but you haven't. But if you raise your hand, you're going to encourage them, that they feel like they're loved and they're in a safe place to admit it, that they're not alone, because Christians aren't perfect, right? We're forgiven and we're progressing. Yes. Okay. So that's for anyone who doesn't feel comfortable raising their hand. It's okay. Regret, shame, guilt, illness, broken relationships. Don't raise your hand here. Jail, divorce, addictions. This is what happens. These are the stains of your sin. This is what's left behind in the wake of destruction behind your bad choices. Okay, this is what's happened. John 10:10, this verse we're talking about tonight. See, there's that's the verse we referenced is the good news, but the bad news is the beginning of the verse, and that is that the enemy, the serpent, when he came, right, and he's still here, and he came to steal, kill, and destroy. And all these lists that I'm giving you, those are the lists of death. They're death. You choose to sin, you choose to die. Like, I'm not like sugarcoating anything. I don't, okay? So if you want that, go somewhere else. Listen, if you choose to sin, you're choosing death. And I can say that because the scriptures say it, that the wages, the payment of your sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus. You choose to sin, you choose to die. So the enemy, he's coming to steal, kill, and destroy. He wants to destroy your health. He wants to destroy this church. He wants to destroy every marriage. He wants to destroy your company. He wants you to lose your job. He wants to take your house away. He wants your kids on drugs. He wants to destroy and kill everything that you hold precious. That's what he wants. And every time you take the bait, you're letting him get a little bit closer to your heart. Don't take the bait. If it smells like sulfur, run. Run. And my heart breaks because every week I watch my loved ones take the bait. And it rips me apart. And I'm begging you, please stop. I don't know how much more pain you can take, but you don't need to take it anymore. You can stop. It's because the good news is that I came that you might have life and have it to the full. That's the NIV. The New American Standard is the verse we saw up on the screen. I came that you might have life and have it abundantly. Now, if you're a King James guy, I don't know where Jerome went. Oh, there he is. If you're a King James guy, you get it even better because it's just like the New American Standard, but he says that you would have it more abundantly. So I guess you get it even better than we do, all right? Just kidding. Our Bible in here that we use most often, the New Living Translation, when it talks about why Jesus came, he said that my purpose in coming is to give them a rich and satisfying life. Who wants that? Every hand should go up. Every hand should go up. This is where the fun is, okay? Like, it sounds good. I want an abundant life, right? I want my life to be good. I don't want my life to be bad. It's been bad long enough. I want it to get better, right? Okay, so that sounds good, but you know what does that look like? You gotta ask that question. What's that look like to have an abundant life? And how do I get it? Over here. You guys over here. What's it look like? Let's say it. What's it look like? Say it out loud. That was weak. So let's try it again. Okay. And over here. How do I get it? Okay, you ready?
What's it look like?
I'm so glad that you asked. It's so good that you guys thought of that because Jesus tells you how to get it right here. It's all right here in the book. Okay, so let me tell you how you get it, what it looks like. First of all, I want to just tell you this, that it looks like this. His name's Jesus Christ. That's what it looks like, okay? He gave us this perfect model, the example. So if you want to know how to live, you read my book. If you want to know what the abundant life looks like, read my book. That's all you have to do, okay? Read my book. What did I do? What did I say? How did I respond to people and situations? So the model is right there in Scripture. And that's why Paul said that you should follow him as he follows Christ. He studied Jesus, and he said, this is the way we're supposed to live. And so he lived his life out just like Jesus did, so you could follow him. And so there should be people in your life that you know are deeply immersed in the Scriptures, so they know Jesus, and you could watch them, and they could be a model for you. You follow them as they follow Christ. And they're going to teach you about Jesus, and he's going to commend to you the truths of Scripture, who Jesus is. And then it's your duty, say it's my duty. It's my duty to pass that on to other people, okay? So we see what does it look like? Well, we see Jesus in Scripture, how he lived. And then also, how do I get it? Well, the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in the believer. So if you're a believer, if you bowed the knee to Jesus and he's your Savior, that same Spirit that raised him out of the grave that day that we celebrate, like, that's crazy. Out of a cold, dead grave, Jesus raises himself. That Spirit lives inside of you. So if you want to live the abundant life, he's given you the Spirit so you can notice what's right and wrong, and then the power to say yes to righteousness and no to sin. It's in there. You just got to tap into it. But before you can tap into it, you have to recognize this as truth in your life. If you're a believer, the Spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in you. You have to know this. It's no more weak, limp Christians. We're powerful. We're powerful. Okay? We're powerful. So, There's lots of ways to attack this whole thing of what does it look like and how do I get it. I'm just going to, there's a ton of different ways we could kind of preach this. I'm going to give you what I think God's given me to share with you. Certainly not the only thing we could talk about. Here's the first thing you got to do to get it. It's simple, right? You just got to say yes. You got to say yes. People that are sitting around waiting for God to bless them, when they haven't said yes to the gift that he gave them in Jesus, you're wasting your time. I'm just telling you the truth. The truth is this, and I'm not ashamed to say it. A lot of people might not say it, but I'm going to say it. There's only one way to God. Like, tolerance, schmollerance. Like, you can be whatever you want. You can worship Gumby for all I care. But he ain't God. There's only one way to the true Creator. And Jesus said it in the Bible, there's only one way. I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and no one gets to the Father except through me. That's it. You have to say yes. You have to say yes. Here's, we're talking about the abundant life. What does it look like? How do I get it? Let's talk about saying yes. Psalm 32 is what it says. Oh, what joy for those whose disobedience is forgiven, whose sin is put out of sight. Yes, what joy for those whose record the Lord has cleared of guilt. When you talk about abundant life, now this is just me talking and you don't have to agree with me by any means, but when I think of the abundant life and I read these words joy, that's what I'm talking about. I think that's what Jesus is talking about. I think that he wants us to have abundant joy. That's what he wants for us, right? And I see that. Listen, let me ask you a question. Ever stand in front of a judge? Don't raise your hand. Joey, put your hand down. He thought he could get away with it because he's in the back of the room. Ratted. Ever stand before the judge? Do you ever get pulled over by a cop for speeding? So you know there's tension there, right? It's tension. Listen, like I just said, there's a singular provision to have your record. Oh my Lord, I'm so Boston. That jumped right out right there. Wow. There's a singular provision for the expunging of your record. And it is in Jesus Christ the Lord. You must say yes. You must say yes. It's not, this is what people do, and it's, I don't know, I guess it's a modern thing. It wasn't like this when I was a kid, but it's not, you know, having your record expunged is not running around frantically trying to pursue and earn karma. I hate karma. Karma's stupid, right? You know why? Because that's not joy. You know what that is? Exhausting. Trying to earn good in your life. It's exhausting. Okay? It's Colossians 1:22. This is the truth. It's not frantically chasing karma around the block like a cat chasing its tail. Colossians 1:22 said that Christ's death in the flesh for the penalty of your sin brings you into God's presence holy and blameless and without a single fault. That's the truth. That's where joy is found. And that alone. So the reason I asked you about getting pulled over, so you're speeding through, I know none of you do this, but just wondering if you're speeding and you get pulled over by the cop, right? They come up to the window and this has never happened to me, but they knock, you know, license, registration, proof of insurance, right? You give them that. How many times does that happen when you're not in a rush? And they always do that when you're in a rush, right? Hence the speeding. You just got busted. Okay. So then what happens? It's the death wait, right? The death wait. You're waiting. It seems like an eternity. It gives you an idea of what eternal life is while that guy's back there feeding his face with donuts and running your tag. No, he's not. He's not. He's Facebooking his friends, okay? But it's the death wait. But then he comes back, right? And he knocks on the window. Yes, no, you've buckled up now, just like he didn't know. And yes, sir, yes. And he says, and you're like you can't even breathe because you know it's a $200 charge coming your way, right? And you're like brown bagging, right? And the guy says, I've decided to give you a warning. Right? And all of a sudden, it goes from I hate those pigs to, oh, I love them. They're just here for our well-being and safety. I appreciate your hard work. Yeah. Right? But there's joy, right? There's joy right there. You felt it. If you've gotten that warning, you deserved to get a ticket, but you got grace, right? You got what you didn't deserve. And there's joy in the forgiveness of your sin, in the cleansing of your guilt. So there is joy in my innocent verdict, right? But so you say yes. So Jesus, I acknowledge that I'm a sinner. I've done everything wrong my whole life. My priorities were wrong. My perspective is wrong. My attitude is wrong. My words are wrong. My eyes are staring where they shouldn't. My hands are wrong. Everything is wrong. I find joy in the wrong stuff. I'm hanging around with the wrong people. I'm doing nothing right. I can't do this anymore. I need you to save me. Awesome. You say yes. And he imparts his perfection. You give him death and he gives you life. That's awesome, right? And there's joy there. There's joy for those whose record has been cleansed of sin. So you see that the Word of God is right again. It's right again. That's why we preach it, because it's never wrong. Okay, so we experience that joy, but then what? How many people in the room were saved 20 years ago? Raise your hand. Okay, how about 30? 40? Okay, yeah, Troy, all right. Okay, some of us are 30, 40 years ago. Okay, that joy that you experienced was a long time ago. But the Bible says, just as you accepted him, so walk in him. He wants you to feel that
joy. When the cop came to your window and he said, it's just a warning. I've been a rotten scoundrel my whole life, but Jesus forgives me. Awesome joy. And he wants you to experience that every single day. Every day. No more hanging my head down, Christians. Woe is me. I make fun of Joey all the time. How you doing? Oh, as good as can be expected. Really? That's not joy. I know he's messing with me now. But that's not the way he wants us to live. He said he came that you may have life and have it abundantly. So just as I accepted him, so walk in him. Did you ever take a kid to a park? They love to play, right? John, you got little boys, right? You got little boys? They love to go to the park. Whose little kids love to go to the park? Well, they love to go to the park. And no matter what you do when you go to the park, you could say, listen, son, when we leave, if you don't cry, I will buy you a pony. And they will still cry. They will still, put here, I got some pictures of kids leaving the park. You got that? Yeah. There he's at the, that's the kids, right? Anyone ever have their kids do that when you try to leave the park? This is what kids do, right? You know why? Because no matter what you say, they've experienced the joy of the park and they don't want to let it go. And that's what you should feel. If you've experienced the joy of the Lord, that's your strength, don't let it go. Grab a hold of that thing and have it every single day of your life. That's what the next thing is. It's the first thing is say yes. The second one is, this is super creative. Don't applaud. Stay yes. I know. Your pastor is very creative. Psalm 16:11 says, in your presence there's fullness of joy. In your presence there is fullness of joy. You know, you can never run so far and so fast that you would not be in God's presence. Do you know that? It doesn't matter where you go. He's there. And he's watching. I'm watching you. That's comforting if you're being a good boy. And that's scary if you think you're hiding something. But you can certainly run so fast and far that you are unaware of his presence. He's always here. Do you know he's here right now? That should scare you a little bit. But it should comfort you at the same time. It's kind of weird, right? You know, you can head knowledge the existence of a transcendent being all day long, but if you do that, doesn't mean you've experienced the love of the Savior who loves your soul. You can quote verses all day long, but never connect intimately with the author of those verses. You know that the people that Jesus was dealing with, the Pharisees, the religious folks, that was them. They knew the Bible by heart. They wouldn't know God if he came up and said boo, because he did. His name's Jesus, and they didn't recognize him. That's how bad it was. Imagine memorizing the Bible, memorizing the book that tells you all about this one person, and that one person walks up to you, and you don't even recognize them. That's stupid, and that's them. Don't be stupid. That's your advice for the night. Don't be stupid. Let me ask you this. You guys ever read that part about Paul when he says, I was one of those guys? Like, I knew everything that the Bible taught. Like, I knew all the words. But it didn't even matter. Like, I didn't even know God. And Paul goes on, I want to say it's in Philippians. He says, you know, the verses aren't good enough. Going into the temple and doing this and that, it's not good enough. He said, and this is crazy, he said, I want to share in Jesus' suffering. I want the pain that he went through so that we could have life, and the shunning and the persecution and the whipping and the beating and people not loving him and not accepting him, all that stuff. Like Paul said,
I want to go through that. Now, who would want to go through that, right? I mean, we've seen the movie. Like, who would want, you know why he wanted to go through it? He wanted to go through the pain and the suffering, he goes on to say, so that I can also experience the resurrection. He said he was willing to suffer. Forget, he doesn't want you to just memorize stuff. He wants you to go through it so that you can experience the delivery from it. He wants you to experience the power of the Holy Ghost. So that he wants you to go through stuff so that he can deliver you from it, so you can realize and experience the power that is God. So not memorizing the verses, but living it out. He wants you to live with Jesus, to enjoy his presence. He wants to be with you every moment. And what he goes through, you go through. What you go through, he goes through. He's just as real and in your face right now as I am with Barbara. He's here right now. And everything you go through, he's going through it with you. But the problem is that we're not aware of the fact that everything that he's going through, he wants you to go through it with him. It goes both ways. It's a relationship there. If you could pick, I know you're all going to go Jesus because you're all Christians, okay? But forget, other than Jesus, who's the one person that you would want to like, especially that lives today, that you'd want to hang out with for a day? Who? Your wife. That's a great answer. Awesome answer. Gumby. Okay, I want a specific person, a name, someone that you want to hang out with. Who? I don't even know who that is because I'm old, but I'm sure he's cool. Who is he?
A rapper.
Okay. Who else?
My father.
Your father. Cool guy, I guess. Okay, I got a guy. I love you. You see me pull it in? Yeah. I got a guy. If I could hang out with anyone on the planet, don't hate, it'd be The Rock. That's who I want to hang out with. All the girls are like, oh, me too. Right, yeah. Drool. Right. I want to hang out with him. He is the coolest dude on the planet. Totally the coolest dude ever. I want to hang out with The Rock. I used to be a huge wrestling fan. Not ashamed to say it. I love it. It's fake, but it's awesome. And he's the funniest dude on the planet. He's a big, bad, funny dude, man. And I want to hang out with that guy big time. But let me ask you a question. If I was up here and I'm preaching and The Rock happened to, you know, bust through that door, because that's what he would do. He wouldn't just open it, right? He'd just blow that thing right down. And he came in here and I'm talking to you guys and he was standing right behind me. Am I in his presence? It's not a trick question. I'm not baiting you. I mean, honestly, am I in his presence?
Yes.
Okay, that's true. That's true. Is it doing me any good? No, not at all. How about if I start what Christians do, you know, quoting all the verses? What if I start quoting all of his catchphrases, you know, and I start, you know, I could smell what The Rock is cooking. What if I do that? And Jabroni Drive and the SmackDown Hotel and all those funny things. Like, what? Is that going to make me intimate with him? Am I in his presence if I just start quoting all of his catchphrases? No. It's in the awareness of his presence. That's where the joy is, right? I want to hang out with The Rock. I want to talk with him. I want to hang out with him. I want to listen to him be funny. I want him to teach me, maybe I want to be a wrestler. I got the physique for it, don't I? So let's maybe Santa, because dream on. I don't even know where I was going with that, but that was good. That was good. But I want it's the awareness of his presence that would bring joy to my life. Right? I want to hang out with Rock, and so just quoting his verses, right?
That's what we do. And he's here, but I'm not aware of it. That's not helping me any. And it's the same thing with God. It's the awareness of God's presence where joy is realized, okay? And he's with us all the time. He's here right now. But sometimes, even when you come to church, you're not aware of his presence. You're listening to some dude yell at you. You're listening to some good voice singing to you, but you don't understand. Like, they're not singing to you. Do you understand? Do you understand the fact that they're not singing to you? That the Lord sings over his people? Do you understand that? Do you understand that when Jessica and Grayson and Daisy and Candy, they're all up here singing, you go, oh, that's a nice voice. No, it's not. That's God singing over you. He's singing to you because he loves you. He's here all the time, as real as I'm standing here right now. He is here. He's here. And so the challenge for us is to get into that presence and that awareness of his presence where the fullness of joy is. And in James, it says that if we would, here's the challenge. If you will draw close to him, he will draw close to you. That's a promise of Almighty God. The one who spoke and planets came out of his mouth has promised if you draw close to him, he will draw close to you. He's not going to back away. His ears are not clogged. He's not too busy. You draw close to him and he's coming after you, guaranteed, all the time. And listen, I need to clarify this, okay? We're a casual church. I get it, right? We're casual, but our perspective and our view of God has to be appropriate, right? You can draw close to him, but that doesn't mean, yo, JC, what up? Okay? Listen, heaven forbid we talk to the creator of the universe in that tone. Okay? You just can't come. Listen, Jesus made it available for you to talk to God. That doesn't mean you burst down the door and say, what up, Jesus? How you doing? That's not the way it works. Okay, God is God, and he has decided how we should come into his presence. We're thankful that the curtain has been torn and we could come into the Holy of Holies, but he says in Psalm 95, too, he says, let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. With thanksgiving. Don't just come in with your laundry list of, hey, I need this and I need that and hook me up with this and hook me up with that. Whoa, slow your roll, brother. First things first, come to him with thanksgiving, singing and shouting songs of praise. See, that's just the way God wants it. He's ordained it to be that way. When you come in and you pray, it's not just what I need. He's interested in what you need. But he's really interested in his praises. That's just who he is. And so if you want to experience not just that he's here, like an awareness like, oh yeah, he's here. But if you want to experience his manifest presence, like that, you know what? This is the manifest presence of a chair. Like it's really here right now. You can touch it. You can move it. You can sit on it. It's real. And that's what you should be going after all the time. Don't settle for omnipresence when manifest presence is available to you. Don't shortchange yourself, okay? And so when you come into the presence of God, it should be the pursuit of his manifest presence. You know how you get it? Earnest pursuit. Earnest pursuit. You got to want it. You got to want it. You can't take no for an answer. You have to have an attitude of, I will not be denied. I'm coming after you, Jesus, and I'm not going to be stopped. It's the lady in the Bible. It's not just a cool story. It's there for you. It's the lady who's got this blood hemorrhage for like years and years and years. And I can't remember how many years it was, maybe 12. And she spent all her money and she's bleeding. And so she's, you know, like weak and anemic and she's got a blood problem. So socially and religiously, you were an outcast. Like you couldn't even hang out with people. And so she's, back then, she's a woman. She's religiously unclean like a leper. She has no money. She's been bleeding for 12 years. So what? She's weak probably, right? Frail. And she is rushing through the crowd because she's like, I'm getting to Jesus. I need to get to Jesus. And she pushes through the crowd to get to him. That's not just a cool story to praise this chick. It's for you.
That's the attitude he wants from you. He said, the eyes of the Lord go back and forth across the earth, looking to strengthen those whose hearts are completely his. Come after me. Come after me. God isn't honoring some, he's not making a habit of honoring some half-hearted, lukewarm, kind of, sort of, you know, obligatory prayers. I show up on occasion, you know, I'll go to church if there's no good game on and I don't have anything else to do and I'll give God my time. Listen, keep it at home, dude. Keep it at home. Let me tell you, if I know Jesus, and I don't know him as good as a lot of people do, but I know him pretty good. We're pretty tight. I can tell you right now, Jesus is totally not into playing church. Totally not into playing church. He wants a family that is hot on his trail all the time, coming after him. Hebrews 10:6, God is a rewarder of those who earnestly seek him. You can say amen if you want to. It's okay. Seriously, I love that. I think God likes that too. I just think he does. I think that means that, you know what, I agree with you, Lord, and that fires me up. And I think that he would like to hear that stuff. Here's another one. I'll give you another run at it. Deuteronomy 4:29, if you search for God with all your heart and soul, you will find him. Amen. Yeah, you guys are awesome. I like, it's not my church. It's Jesus' church, right? But I've been here since day one, and I want some perks. I want some perks. I want a church that's stinking fired up about Jesus. I want you to shout at me. I want you to be excited. I just want to let you know that you're not in a church that you have to be like super reverent. God is so good. He is so good. I know I look like I'm living in hell, but God is good. Yeah. I'm so out on that. I'm gonna read you another verse, and I want to see how you guys respond to your pastor's plea. You ready? Jeremiah 23:13. If you search for me wholeheartedly, you will find me. It's a start. Perfect time for what I'm about to tell you. In a corporate setting like this, music's not the only way to worship. You guys, we're good with that, right? Like what you're doing right now is worship because you said, God, I'm going to give you an hour of my time. We'll listen to you. That's worship. You're elevating him. You're giving him value, right? You're attributing value to him. But during music, like in a corporate setting like this, there are some that as soon as the music starts playing, and I know this because I hope this doesn't ruin it, but while you guys do it, like, I'm worshiping too, but sometimes I peek, okay? I'm peeking at you because I want to see how you're doing. I love you. I need to see evidence of growth. I just want to see evidence of growth. And someone who used to sit like this, I'm not. Then they start doing this. And then sometimes you'll see them go like this. And then once in a while you'll see them go like this. And then they go like this. And then one day you just see them going, right? That's awesome, right? Yeah, that's awesome. So I peek. I sit over there and I peek. But there's certain people, when the music starts, their eyes close, their hands are thrown up, right? And they're just totally gone. Did you ever see The Jungle Book? With Baloo, and he's dancing, you know. He's like, I'm gone, man. So gone. That's what we are, right? Some of you guys are doing that while you're worshiping. I love that, right? I love that. And you know, I peek, and you know the people that are like, man, please don't let this music end, man. We're in the Holy of Holies right now. Like, I am so hugging God, and he is so hugging me, and I feel safe and loved and empowered. Nothing is better than this. Like, please don't stop the music. Those people are engaged, man. They're engaged mind, heart, soul, and strength. Every bit of who they are is completely engaged intellectually, emotionally, physically, spiritually. They are there.
That's what Paul says in Romans 12. He said, because of what God's done, give your bodies as a living sacrifice. Like everything, my mind, my heart, my soul, my strength, my thoughts, what am I thinking about, my heart, my affections, my soul. It's like my eternity's yours and my strength. I'm coming after you, Lord, and nothing's going to distract me. Here I am. I'm yours. He says in Romans 12, he goes on to say, that's your reasonable worship. In other words, it could get better. But he'll settle for everything. It's a high watermark, but that's what he's shooting for. Man, the day, think about it, I want you to dream with me. Dream of the day that you walk into this place or wherever the Lord would take us. And they start playing the music and you look behind you and there's just a tidal wave of this. That's awesome. I dreamt of that. Remember, this is a side note. You remember that song, How Great Is Our God, Chris Tomlin? I had this dream that one day I'm gonna see an ocean wave of this while they played that song. That song, when it first came out, everyone loved it, right? Till the Z played it 42,000 times and ruined it. But it's a good song. And then on our first date, I took Meredith to Night of Joy. And guess who was playing? Chris Tomlin. And we got... I'm such a wimp, I'm sorry. We got to move up front. It was kind of raining, so all those lukewarm Christians ran, right? Not me, right? We got to stand up front, and he starts playing that music, buddy. And there it was, and all of a sudden I turn around. I was like, you've got to be kidding me. It was thousands and thousands of hands, every voice at the top of its lungs just totally worshiping Christ. It was amazing. It was absolutely amazing. That's what God's looking for. But you know, there's those people, and I told you I peek. But there's another group. There's another group. I'm not picking on anyone in particular, but it's the, that's too loud. That's too long. Let's get to the point, preacher. Give me my 5 points to be a better parent. I don't even have those. They're sitting in their seat just as grumpy as I hope I'm not talking about you. But if I am, straighten up. But the problem isn't getting the point. That's not the problem. See, the problem is that they miss the point. That's the problem. That's the problem. See, time basking in God's presence is the point. Like, that's why you should come here. If the band and the singers can sing at all, it's a bonus. If you learn anything from my efforts, it's a bonus and a miracle. It shouldn't matter. There's churches that I've listened to their pastor and he will put you to sleep and they are rocking. You know why? God. Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down, that the mountains might quake in your presence. When the Lord is in the house, there's a voice that's stronger than anything I could yell. And that's all we need. To bask in his presence is all you need. Early church leader, his name is Augustine, had a very famous quote, and he said this, and I think he sums it up just perfectly. He said, the chief end of man is to bring glory to God and to enjoy him forever. That's it. Profound. Simple, but perfect. Now, I want to give you some scripture. I hope you're not in a rush, because I'm not. I want to tell you what I'm talking about. I want to tell you about the problem in people. And it's not me, it's God. He's going to tell you what the problem is, and maybe there's a symptom there that's in your life. Maybe there's a bit of a disease in you, and let God's word speak to you. Do me a favor and go to the Gospel of Luke. Go to Luke chapter 17. I'm talking about the presence of God. In the presence of God, there is fullness of joy. It's God being there that brings the joy. It's not what he says, it's not what he does, it's not what he gives, it's just him. But here's the problem. Luke 17, look at verse 11. There's a story here of Jesus healing these lepers, okay? And so let me read this to you. And if you're there, tell me. Tell me if you're there. Okay, you're there. Okay, awesome. This is a story, and see if you see yourself in this, and here's a problem. Here's a problem that God wants to fix. So as Jesus continues on toward Jerusalem, and this story is endless. Like, we could spend hours. There's tons. Okay, but he's on his way to Jerusalem. The end is near, right? But he reaches the border between Galilee and Samaria, and as he entered a village there, 10 lepers. Okay, these are outcasts. You don't touch them. You don't talk to them. They're leper, unclean. Like, you don't go anywhere near them, right? And these lepers, they stood at a distance because they're not allowed with us. Do you understand? They're diseased and yucky, so you can't go near them. That was the culture at the time. They didn't have medicine to fix them. They're just a mess. And so lepers have skin falling off the bone. It was highly contagious. So they're at a distance, and they're crying out, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." He looks at them and he says, "Go show yourselves to the priest." Now did he didn't say you're healed. And this is for someone here tonight. He didn't say you're healed. He said, "Go show yourself to the priest." Now, the reason why I did this, because in that time, only the priest could declare that you were clean to bring you back into society. It was the burden was on the priest at the temple to decide if you've actually been healed somehow. And only on his stamp of approval could you go back in. So he didn't say you're healed. He said, "Go show the priest. Go talk to the priest," right? Go show yourself to the priest. Here's the word for you. And as they went, they were cleansed of their leprosy. If you're sitting around waiting for God to bless you and he hasn't, maybe it's because you're not being obedient. If he says, "Go show the priest," what happened? As they were obedient, so comes the blessing. We do it different because we're in America. We want the blessing, and then we'll follow Jesus. Hook me up. Show me who you are, Lord. Show me you're awesome, and then I'll follow you. No, you're reading it, right? I didn't make it up. As they went, in their obedience, they were healed. Okay, let's move on. One of them, okay, as they went, they were cleansed of their leprosy. One of them, when he saw that he was healed, came back to Jesus, shouting, "Praise God!" He fell to the ground at Jesus' feet, worship, thanking him for what he had done. Here's the crazy thing, the man was a Samaritan. That's not just no big deal. Like, Jews didn't hang out with Samaritans. They were the outcasts. They were no good, right? And the only reason why it says that the man was a Samaritan is that obviously some of the people, at least one, if not more in that 10, were Jews. So you'd think maybe them, they would recognize after all these years, God is finally here. Woohoo! And I'm gonna go praise him for what he's done. But no, only the Samaritan. Jesus asked, "Didn't I heal 10 men? Where are the other 9? Has no one returned to give glory to God except this foreigner?" And Jesus said to the man, "Stand up and go. Your faith has healed you." Earlier, it says, one of them, when he saw he was healed. Okay, that's a different word than the last word of healed in that paragraph. The first time healed is used, it's a word in Greek that says healed of a physical affliction. The second time, your faith has healed you, is sozo. That means saved. Do you see the problem here? The problem here is that people want what Jesus will give them. And once they get it, they're out of here. And the true joy is this guy. Do you see? He came back. and he saw that the real prize was not the healing of what God could give him. He saw the real prize was God himself. And he came back and he worshiped Christ. And what did Jesus say? That right there, that saved you. You are saved. You're not just healed. You're saved forever. Sozo, healed, made whole. Here's another one, John chapter 6. John chapter 6 is another story just like this. And I'm repeating these things over and over again because I want to drive them home. The Bible says that we should let God transform us by changing the way we think. And that's what we're shooting for right here. I'm not disguising that. So here's another one. There's a crowd of people. Jesus is going around performing all these miracles and everything. And in John chapter 6, verse 26, Jesus starts talking again. He looks at these people and he says, I tell you the truth, you want to be with me because I fed you. Not because you understand the miraculous signs, but don't be so concerned about perishable things like food. Spend your energy seeking the eternal life that the Son of Man can give you. Do you know what he means by understanding the miraculous signs? Now, they weren't just done to actually heal someone. Like, that's a byproduct. That's good. Do you know why? Do you know why Jesus did this? To prove who he was. To prove who he was. Deity had hit the planet, and he was showing them who he was. So his miracles are to draw people to God, not to just have blindness healed. Like, that's awesome if you have cancer and he heals you. Like, that's awesome. But what's more awesome is when the healed person goes, wow, that was God, and gives himself to the Lord for eternal healing. That's the reason for the healing. Romans 1:25, they traded the truth about God for a lie. So they worshiped and served the things God created instead of the Creator himself, who is worthy of praise. And you see that in Luke, they were worshiping, in a sense, what God had done for them. They were so happy about what Jesus had done for them that they forgot Jesus himself. The true joy is Christ. It's not the healing. It's the same thing here in this story in John. They were worshiping things that don't matter. They were only coming after him because of what he could do for them. Jesus, if you get me out of this mess, I will never drink again. Anyone? Listen, this one's going to sting a little. If you get me out of this mess, I won't cheat on him ever again. Don't raise your hand. But we've been there. And soon as he delivers, right back. Right back. Ultimate joy isn't found in what Jesus does, what Jesus gives, not even what he says. The true prize is Jesus Christ himself. So let's finish up here. In closing up our night, I want to clarify the fact that I'm not telling you that enjoying the things that Jesus gives is by any means bad. All good things come from above. And so, just like unbelievers can enjoy good things too. Do you know that? Before you were a believer, did you love a good pizza? I went up to Chicago recently and visited with Kyle and Jamie. You know, they had their baby, which is awesome. But I went and visited with them, and I got to have Chicago-style pizza for the first time. Dude. Madness, right? Good. Yeah. It was crazy. And you know that unbelievers can enjoy that. They go to Chicago sinning like crazy, and they love that pizza, and so don't I. But there's a difference between the non-believer and the believer. See, for the believer, we get to not only enjoy that deep dish Chicago-style pizza, but with every bite we can thank the one who made it. It's a
deeper, better level of joy and thanksgiving that a believer cannot appreciate. It would be awful. I think it would be awful to believe in karma. I really do. I think it would be awful to believe in karma that says that I have to somehow earn the good things that come into my life. That would be lame. I want to start a new movement. Down with karma. I hate that guy. I hate that word. That's the poison of our culture. Karma. What is that? That somehow you do enough good stuff and then good stuff will circle the globe and come back and what is that? It's foolishness. Or how about luck? That somehow, like, good stuff is just going to randomly drop out of the sky and fall on top of your life. That's lame, too. You're selling yourself short if you believe in luck. Because the truth of it is that there's a heavenly Father who loves you and loves to give you good gifts. Now, just think about that. What would you rather be a product of? Random luck that drops out of the sky and hopefully you're in the right place at the right time? Or be able to live in peace knowing that no matter where you go, that there's a Father in heaven who adores you and just wants to bring you good gifts. Doesn't that, I mean, listen, I want you to be a Christian. If you're not a Christian, please say yes. But even if you're not, doesn't that second thing sound so much better? To just know that you're loved and that no matter where you go, no matter what you're doing, that there's this Father who just adores you and loves you and wants to bring you good things. Good stuff and good experiences is just that. It's good. But God is great. He's great. And in His presence, there's fullness of joy. There's fullness of joy. So, since I'm not the Holy Spirit and I can't tell what's going on in your heart, I don't know if you've ever really been in the presence of God, because if you've never said yes one time, if you've never initiated this relationship by saying yes and had your record expunged of all your guilt and shame and regret and embarrassment and fear and death and divorce and jail and all the things that have just clung to you, all the stains of your sin. Like, if you haven't gotten rid of that thing, it's because you haven't said yes yet. And I can only tell you, because I can't prove it to you with some algebraic equation, I can't prove it that way, but I can tell you this, that if you'll say yes and mean it, you will experience a joy you've never had. And I just want to give you the opportunity to say yes. That's all. Just say yes. The Bible's clear. I don't know what church has taught you, but the Bible is clear that if you just call upon the name of the Lord and just say, Jesus, save me. I am wrong. You are right. I believe you died on that cross to pay for my sin. Be the Lord of my life. Like, that's all you got to do. Just something like that. You don't have to stand up. You don't have to come to the altar. You don't have to raise your hand. You don't have to fill out a card. You don't have to do nothing. Just do that. Okay, but if you've said yes and you've experienced that joy initially, He wants to take you to the next step of that staying yes. He wants you to enjoy the presence of Him. Like Augustine said, the chief end of us, why we're even here, is to bring glory to God and to enjoy Him forever. So this is the thing. He's here. He's here right now. But you're looking at me. And you need to get your eyes off of me. Okay? We need to practice the presence of God. This is going to be a weird thing. If you've been coming to this church, this is going to be a little bit weird for you because it's different. We're going to take an extended period of time
until this omnipresent, manifest, present God tells Jessica and Grayson that he's done, we're going to let you enjoy his presence by closing your eyes, and you should do that now. Don't look at me anymore. No one should even know I'm here. I want you to bask in his glory, because when the heavens open and God comes down and he speaks to you, those will be words you will never forget. He wants to hug you. He wants to save you. He wants to bless you. He just wants to experience you, and he wants you to experience him. So listen, you can get on your knees. You can stand. You can lift your hands. The Bible says that when this is what God wants, that when people gather, they would pray with holy hands lifted high. And remember what he said, as they went to go show the priest in obedience, they were healed. He said he wants holy hands lifted high. You want to experience the presence of God, do it his way and expect to hear from him. Spend time in his presence now. And as they play, let him talk to you, you talk to him. We usually pass out communion. We're not going to do that tonight, but we have communion available for you up here on these pallets. If you want to at any time to come and take communion with the Lord, go up and take it, and take it at your own speed, at your own pace. And they're just going to play music. And if you want to sit here for a while and just enjoy his presence, sit here and enjoy his presence. If you need to go home, go home. But we're going to enjoy God's presence now.